Next, we're going to move on to Dan Desmond from the CME Group, Negotiating Respecting Perspectives for Tech Success. And he's got a presentation, right? On.
Okay. We're juggling as we go. We're close. It is about teamwork, so we're just kind of shuffling as we go. So thank you very much. First of all, I wanted to thank all of you for being here today, and it's interesting. I'm going to go way back in time till about 9 o'clock this morning. And that was a long time ago. We've digested a lot of information. We're just getting started. And it's all through participation from all the people here, yet some of us come from the private sector, some from academia, some from nonprofits. And is anybody here from the government? Yes, we do have some people from the government here. So I'd like to start with something that we all have to overcome, because if you walk around, get a chance to walk around and see these on the boards, I looked at the challenges because those are the barriers we have to overcome. Because if you have leadership and you don't overcome the challenges, you're not leading, you're just talking. And so that's one of the real facts here. And if you look across these and you look at the challenges, I'd like to introduce you to the model of mutual distrust. Because between academia, government, private sector, and nonprofits, there is a model of mutual distrust. We trust each other to share information as long as they give it to us, but not us to them. Even if we're academia, is the grant going to end? What are we going to do when the grant ends? How are we going to move forward? If we're going to change the world, those four sectors need to align. And I'm going to go back to, where's Nathan? Is he still here? Okay. Well, Nathan, one of the things he talked about was how to be participatory. And if you think about participation, it has nothing to do with governments, nonprofits, the private sector, or academia. It has to do with individuals. And we're all individuals who need to participate. So how did I get here, and how this come to being, and what is the beach all about, the beacon? So I'm going to take you back, and in 2009, the United States had the American Recovery and Reinvestment Act, a whole bunch of money, TARP, all those types of things. But one of the things they decided to do was to implement electronic health records across the United States, and highly, to the tune of $16, $18 billion, incentivize providers and hospitals to implement electronic health records so that they could be interoperable. Not so that they were interoperable, so that they could be interoperable. But they also needed to be a little more forward-leaning. So the government performed its leadership role, which was to inspire and provide funding to encourage people to move forward, and they provided funding to the academic sector and nonprofits and state governments around the country to do this. In the forward-leaning component, they created something called the beacon communities, beacons of light, so we can see to the future. One of them was in San Diego County. The University of California, San Diego, had a beacon grant for $15, $16 million, but they had all 19 hospital systems and all of the providers in San Diego County working with them. And they also had San Diego County. So they had all four sectors working together on a project. 2 years into the project, all of the check marks were done on the list. They were successful. Every single one was successful. Then they said, when the grant ends, are you going to still participate? Well, are you paying us? No, there was no continued participation. So they did something very, very unique, and they pulled the plug. They said, we met the grant, we were successful, but it's not sustainable. We have to find a way of getting all of these organizations to find a mutual interest to move forward. 6 months later, they decided that there was no mutual interest in moving forward. But everyone had an intent, but they couldn't translate it to terms. So in the middle of last year, with the timeline winding down to September 30th, 2013, when the grant funding expended, they transitioned everything that worked, which was about 20% of the technology, but 80% of the participants, to an operational nonprofit. They then said, we need to continue innovating and moving forward, but they could no longer call it the beacon, because that was the path forward. So what they did is they combined with the other 18, they combined with universities across the country, including MIT, Harvard, the entire University of California system, Stanford, Duke University, Washington, and others. 5 minutes. And I'm right on time, so that's good. So as they did this with the beach, they created the beach, and they included a novel public-private partnership. And the way they did that was by saying, how do we build success? And so part of this goes back to what Sandy was talking about in the beginning, but more importantly, what we've heard from people since then. It's about listening to them and starting small. So if you have a nonprofit and you have grants, they end, they terminate. What happens is everything shuts off, you get a new grant, you start back up again. So they said we need a consistent infrastructure to move this forward, and lessons learned and best practices that end up in a document in a folder on a disk drive somewhere that's turned off or of no value whatsoever. So I'm going to turn that over to Kevin next to talk about, because he'll be bringing that up. So this is kind of the setup to get him rolling. So as they did this, I can give you three quick examples, and this will really bring this to the genesis, and I'll just hand it over to him if that works with you. Okay, so it'll save time too. So the first part with this is, how many people have been to an emergency department in their life? Okay, so some of you may have gone in an ambulance. So the two leaders for this were Ted Chan and James Klein, two doctors at University of California of San Diego, Department of Emergency Medicine. And what they said is, the more I know, the more I can create a picture of what patient's going to come in the door, the better. Ambulance, can you send me data about what you're doing, what you're finding about that patient before they get here? Absolutely. Check mark, project done. Then they said, can we keep it going? Well, that costs money to do that. We don't have the money to sustain this. What they found out by digging in and starting small is that if the emergency department would tell them when they discharge the patient and give them the data, the ambulance company could bill faster. Now they're willing to share the data because they got something in return. Had nothing to do with the care. The second thing that happened is we have public health departments across the country who are always challenged for funding. And in their challenging for funding, they said, this is great, you gave $16 billion to the healthcare industry, nothing to us, and they're supposed to send us data. We have a hospital that sends 7,000 faxes per day, 7 days a week, to public health. Everyone in the room started chuckling, 7,000 faxes a day, except for the public health person who was saying, I've been fighting this, how many staff do I have looking at, I'm not looking at 7,000 faxes a day. They need to change their perception. So part of this is, how do we build these bridges to do this? So I'm probably down about a minute. So in the last minute, I'll bring it up. So how was this coming together? So one of the unique features, aspects of this with the beach is they said, we have to have flexible models so that we can continue sustain moving forward, but we have to build common pictures of how people work together, and we have to shut up and listen on what they're trying to do and what their problems are and what they're trying to accomplish. Giving true credit to Linda with participatory design. But we've seen this in California with the First Five Commission through her work, but now we're seeing it at a tangible level where instead of saying we want to treat people when there's a disaster, they're sick, the medical reserve corps and the emergency departments, we want to have people to be healthy and well, a healthy and well corps. That's starting now with the California Health Corps as a pilot project to do this, where they're saying if we take libraries and we take community centers and we take clinics, community clinics, safety net clinics, FQHCs. What can we do to optimize the care we provide for the person coming in the door within 2 hours? How can we help them and educate them and build those processes? These are projects that are happening because there are multiple nonprofits. No one's doing this project. They're all working together through this collaborative at the beach. So that means that none of the participants control the money. Separate fiscal sponsorship. So there are creative ways that you can do these things. And we found the most and biggest interest was from other countries, not domestically for doing this. So with that, I'm going to turn it over to Kevin, who will explain how we continue the IT, because if you can't build on the lessons learned and best practices, we are guaranteed to repeat our, yes. I'll leave it for you.